Hello and welcome to the Angus Report, a news program geared toward cattle producers. I'm Bob Zimmerman.
And I'm Paige Wallace. From American Angus Association headquarters in St. Joseph, Missouri, we bring you the week's top headlines, including a look at a major retailer's decision to carry choice beef and its effects on the quality beef business.
The Environmental Protection Agency pushes back its deadline for farmers and ranchers to complete plans for oil spills and waterway protection.
We take a look at the fate of the U.S. Farm Bill, given the recent breakdown in super committee negotiations. Are automatic cuts in our future?
Neville Spear of Western Kentucky University will share findings from his recent white paper that takes a close look at crossbreeding.
And cattlemen gather for the Range Beef Cow Symposium, one of the best educational workshops available for ranchers.
Also, Cargill Meat Solutions' Glenn Dolezal talks about practices each industry segment can use to ensure beef quality and demand.
This is the Angus Report.
Our top story for the week. Time ran out a couple weeks ago for a super committee to develop a federal debt reduction plan, a plan that was also supposed to include provisions for the 2012 Farm Bill. For the past several months, lawmakers were charged with reducing the federal deficit by $1.2 trillion over a decade. But as the Thanksgiving deadline came and passed, many are left wondering, what'll happen next? Unless a bipartisan agreement is reached, the result of the committee's inaction could mean budget cuts across the board starting in fiscal year 2013. This budget uncertainty could mean real economic problems for businesses and producers trying to plan for the next year. Now, as for the fate of the Farm Bill, it will go back to the beginning of the legislative process. Agriculture committees in the House and Senate will have to finalize the new bill before the current one expires on October 1, 2012, indicating continued gridlock. Also making news headlines this week is Walmart's decision to begin carrying choice-grade beef. Experts suggest this will create a bump in the choice select market. John Sticca of Certified Angus Beef explains the impact they expect on the brand.
Well, without a doubt, the widening of the choice select spread has been a very hot topic here as of late, and has really sent a message that the quality of beef movement is alive and well. Just as we have experienced at Certified Angus Beef for the last 5 years with our growth in sales. You know, obviously a big part of that discussion and the buzz has been around Walmart's move to carry choice beef and the impact and outcome that that could ultimately have on our industry. I mean, from our standpoint at Certified Angus Beef, we don't know Walmart's business, obviously, but any move in quality or move forward in quality, we believe long-term is in line with even what our mission statement is at Certified Angus Beef, to deliver taste to the consumer every time. You know, without a doubt, it's been positive for Angus breeders today as we look at the rewards that they've been able to see in comparison to lower quality products when selling cattle on the grid. What's been interesting, though, is to keep in mind where that the spreading or the widening of the spread has come from. It's not just been an increase in the choice price, but a significant decrease in the price and value of select grading cattle.
Only time will tell how the change will affect the nation's supply of high-quality beef.
The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency has announced a new deadline for farmers to complete plans to prevent oil spills and protect waterways. The Spill Prevention Control and Countermeasure Plans, also known as SPCC, are maintained by the farm owner and only submitted to the EPA if a spill is reported.
It's an EPA regulation that comes from the Clean Water Act that's been on the books for quite a while. And this is to help facilities get in compliance with the Clean Water Act.
Essentially, it applies to farms that store oil and fuel products, but there's been some confusion. Energy management specialist Scott Frazier helped sort it out.
There was an SPCC deadline that was to be November 10th of this year, 2011, and that's when all SPCC qualified facilities would have to have their SPCC plans. And then the EPA kind of at the last minute pushed that back to May 10th, 2013. For SPCC plans for certain facilities.
As a result, many producers have new questions about what the plan involves and whether it applies to them.
The facility owner, operator, whoever this applies to, needs to go to the EPA website, which will be showing on the screen, and contact the EPA and look at the requirements for SPCC. The website is fairly straightforward, and there are some kind of tutorials on the website.
According to the EPA, the deadline extension was offered because of the widespread flooding and devastating fires seen on farmland across the country.
A new white paper from Western Kentucky University, Professor Neville Spear says, long-established research supporting crossbreeding often fails to make a case for profitability. While well-planned and executed crossbreeding works for some, Spear explains, more pounds doesn't always equal more dollars.
We recognize that heterosis indeed exists, and there's no denying that. And then the question becomes, okay, at what cost? Because it's always, the mantra is free lunch, right? So if we introduce heterosis into a cow herd, it's a free lunch and there is no cost. Well, the paper really begins to look at some of the issues of, well, maybe there is a cost. What are those costs? And the risk-reward relationship, there's several major factors. First of all, we've changed the marketing system, where all of a sudden now producers are being rewarded for specific attributes, premiums have appeared, and discounts also, where those didn't really exist 30 years ago. We worked strictly in a commodity business. And that's not to say we're not in a commodity business, but those value differentials certainly appear now, and producers are seeking to grab those. The other thing that matters here is that many of the assumptions that we made previously have disappeared. Those big major growth differences that we tried to capture through heterosis and or complementarity are gone.
Visit cabpartners.com to read Spear's full research paper.
Body condition scoring is a useful tool cattlemen can use to determine their cowherd's nutritional needs. Using a 1-9 scoring system, cattle producers are able to identify optimal body condition and adjust feeding strategies accordingly.
Keep track of condition score of the cows, especially for spring calving cows. Body condition score 5 at the time of calving for mature cows, 6 for first calf heifers. The other thing that a best management practice would be, the idea would be to sample and analyze all feedstuffs that are going to be used during that winter feeding program. Feed costs are the highest cost for any cow-calf producers. Understanding what you have on hand, and then if you need to go out and buy anything to meet that requirement, then you know what you need to buy.
Visit cowbcs.info for more information on how to body condition score your herd.
The American Angus Association continues its popular I Am Angus television series Monday, December 19th. The next installment of the documentary series features America's ranching heritage and traditions. Tune in Monday, December 19th at 8 p.m. Eastern on RFD TV. When the Angus Report returns, we look at EPDs at your fingertips, the American Angus Association's AAA login program.
Plus, Glenn Dolezal discusses how the industry has made progress in growing demand together.
First, we check in on the latest cattle market news with our market update, brought to you by CattleFax.
Hello, I'm Lance Zimmerman with the CattleFax update. The Chicago Mercantile Exchange reports a daily 7-day weighted average price for USDA reported feeder steer sales. The value represents the composite sale price for 650 to 849 pound steers, and is typically referred to as the CME feeder index price. It is used by the exchange to determine the official cash settlement price for feeder cattle futures contracts. The price is also useful for understanding fundamentals in the cash feeder cattle market. The feeder index reached a new all-time high at $144.17 per hundredweight on December 1st, and it's the third time the index has established a new high in the last 4 trading days. The previous highs were established this summer when the index rallied $15, reaching more than $139 per hundredweight in July. Prices fell quickly after the highs and remained somewhat range-bound until a fall low was established at $132 per hundredweight. There's reasons to believe prices won't be retreating from these highs as quickly. Similar to last year, the fall price rally has been a slower, more sustained price increase than earlier this year. Momentum indicators based on the index price show the rally from recent weeks has been considerably more gradual than this summer, never exceeding 3% on any given day. Cheaper corn and stronger fed cattle prices this winter have been supportive to the feeder cattle market. Supply fundamentals also support stronger prices into next year. This is good news for producers looking to sell feeder cattle at the end of this year and into 2012. Feeder cattle prices could move to spring highs in the mid-150s to low $160 price range if these trends continue. For the Angus Report and CattleFax, I'm Lance Zimmerman.
To learn more about CattleFax, your leading source for beef industry market information, visit CattleFax.com.